May be seated.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Professor Ron Carlson. It's my privilege to welcome you to this special session of the Georgia Supreme Court. We're making a bit of history this morning. This is the first time in the history of UGA that fully nine justices have sat in special session here in court. We welcome you, and justices, we are delighted that you are here. Thank you. Before I turn it over to Justice Hines, I want to recognize a couple of folks to my left. Dean Rutledge, whom you will hear from at the end of the program. And then next to him, Justice George Carley and Mrs. Carley. Justice Carley served a distinguished career on this court. He's also a double dog, and he returned to the law school numerous times during his service on the court, and we appreciated it very much to judge our moot court mock trial teams. And with that, Justice Hines, I'll turn the program over to you.
Thank you very much, Professor Carlson, for those remarks. The Supreme Court of Georgia is truly delighted to be here today to the flagship university and to sit in this courtroom. It's a pleasure to have these distinguished attorneys with us to argue today, and we appreciate always hearing good arguments. I would like to take just a few moments and introduce to you the members of this court and say a word or two about them because I'm very proud of them. And I'm delighted to have an opportunity to make my friends and colleagues known to you. Starting at my far right is Justice Nels Peterson. I hate to say it, but because of my advanced days, I have to look carefully to see that far. Justice Peterson was the president of the student body at Kennesaw State University, and he then went to Harvard to law school. I would like to tell you that I also went to Harvard Law School. I did not matriculate there, but I had this really nice teaching from him. But he also had a distinguished career in private practice, and then he served as the first Solicitor General in the Attorney General's Office of the State of Georgia. And he clerked for Judge William Pryor on the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals. Next to him is a Georgia Bulldog, and that is Justice Keith Blackwell. He is a double dog. Keith has had a distinguished career himself. I'm gonna brag on my court a little bit. He was the valedictorian of his high school class. He was the first undergraduate here of Georgia undergraduate, and was the singular first undergraduate of Georgia's law school. And he clerked, I think, Judge Edmondson did on the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals. Next to him was Justice Carol Hunstein, dear friend, colleague I've had the pleasure of serving with for a number of years, former president of the Council of Superior Court Judges and a former Chief Justice of this court. It's a pleasure to have her. I want you to see this fellow to my right here, Harold Milton. He went off the path a little bit. He went to undergraduate at Auburn, where he was the president of the student body. And because of my advanced age, actually, Justice Milton worked one time for me. So it's a real treat for me to have a colleague and a friend now serving with me. He did come, he redeemed himself by coming to Georgia's law school to be doing the league and to my left, a distinguished lawyer, one person who's practiced law for many years and has served so well in my state for many years, is also a former law graduate of the University of Georgia, and he is also a former Chief Justice of this court. A beacon in the law, Justice Bob Benham, thank you. Going down here, David Nahmias is Justice David Nahmias. Again, I'm proud of all of them. Justice Nahmias was the singular star student in high school for the state of Georgia. He goes to Duke, where he graduates number two overall. He actually matriculated at Harden's Law School, law school up there, and I think graduated cum laude from Georgia from Harden's Law School. The life of colleague and friend, Justice David Nahmias. To him is Judge Justice Michael Boggs, who served on the Georgia Court of Appeals, a graduate of Georgia Southern and a graduate of Mercer Law School, a former representative and a former member of the Court of Appeals of Georgia, Justice Michael Boggs. And then to the far left, Justice Britt Grant, who is our third clerk for a Circuit Court of Appeals, I believe Judge Kavanaugh on the D.C. Circuit. She worked for him. She went to Wake Forest, Stanford Law School, and served in the White House as an attorney besides having a distinguished career in private practice. She was the second Solicitor General of the state of Georgia in the Attorney General's office. So I'm very proud of this court. And by virtue of my old age and white hair, I'm the Chief Justice. I would like to take this time on behalf of all of my friends and colleagues on this bench to welcome all of you to today's special session of the Supreme Court of Georgia. We especially want to welcome those of you who are law students, as well as the distinguished faculty, the undergraduates, and also members of the Western Circuit Bar Association. I hope your experience today is both interesting and instructive. We're extremely grateful to your fine dean, a wonderful dean and a legal scholar, Dean Peter B. Bo Rutledge of the Law School, for hosting us today. And I also want to thank a longtime friend, the Callaway Chair of Law Emeritus, Professor Ron Carlson, who helped make it possible today. We appreciate Professor Carlson arranging so much of this, so we're very grateful. Professor Carlson also has a son, Mike, who's a distinguished prosecutor in my home county of Cobb. And I will say this, he also has a granddaughter, Marquita Carlson, who is an undergraduate here at the University of Georgia. As I said, this is a very special occasion for our court. I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, a sizable number of our state Supreme Court justices, both past and present, are alumni of this most distinguished law school. They include, as I said, my dear friends and colleagues, Presiding Justice Melton, Justice Benham, Justice Blackwell, and the most noble of us all, former Chief Justice George Carley, who is here with his wife, Sandy. We certainly appreciate Justice Carley and Sandy being here. Anytime you have a court and Justice George Carley is there, it makes it better. I can assure you of that. We appreciate that. I will tell you, as we gather here today, many federal and state courts throughout Georgia are being presided over by graduates of this very distinguished law school, and that is simply no surprise. You have an expert faculty, you have wonderful programs, and tremendous students. Every one of you can be proud that this law school is consistently ranked one of the best in the nation, and for that, you can be most proud. I am very proud myself. I'm humbled to be a member of your board of visitors. Personally, the Hines family has a Bulldog connection that goes pretty deep. My son, daughter, and son-in-law all earned degrees from the University of Georgia, my son-in-law being a practicing attorney. And our son, Hal, actually was kicker from 1996 to 1999. And I can remember a lot of days in Sanford Stadium and other places in it. You're going to feel some excitement and a little terror that your son kicked in front of 100,000 people. So this is like coming home to many of us, and we're honored to hold court at Georgia's flagship university. We really appreciate that. And I would like to take just a little bit this morning and acknowledge those providing security to this special event. They include Senior Trooper Dexter Harden. I'm trying to find the dude to my left here, Master Trooper Henry Dyer. I saw Trooper Dyer, where's Trooper Dyer? Over to my right, and the University of Georgia's Police Department. We really appreciate your services. As I said, finally, we are honored to have with us this morning again Chief Justice, former Chief Justice George Carley, and his wife Sandy, for the three. So thank all of you for coming this morning, and thank you for your kind welcome, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to hear the very distinguished attorneys argue before this court. I would just give you just a little bit of a hint. If you've got any electronic devices, would you be kind enough to turn them off before we begin? Sometimes they go off at the opportune time, so if you would do that. And with that, I want to ask our clerk, Madam Clerk. And now our clerk here is Ms. T. Barnes, distinguished attorney herself, and we will be the finest clerk in the United States of America. Sitting next to her is likewise our Chief Deputy Clerk, Ms. T. Milton, again a distinguished attorney. We believe the finest chief deputy in the United States, so if we say that. So with those remarks, Madam Clerk, I ask you, are there any requests for admissions this morning?
Yes, Your Honor. The following named applicants have properly certified applications, and I respectfully move for their admission to the bar of the Supreme Court of Georgia.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. And ladies and gentlemen, as your name is called, if you would just come forward and stand here right in front of me for a little bit, we'll give you an
Latasha Barnes, Michael Brown, Philip Clark, Lauren Ellison, Andrew Harris, Ethan Macon, Matthew Mosley, and Lisa Taylor.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, again, it's a pleasure to bring forth Georgia to welcome you and to admit you to practice before this bench this morning. At this time, I'm going to administer an oath to you. I ask that you listen to it carefully and repeat after me. If you would you please raise your right hand? I do solemnly swear.
I do solemnly swear
that I will conduct myself.
That I will conduct myself
as an attorney.
As an attorney.
Counsel of this court.
Counsel of this court.
Truly and honestly.
Truly and honestly.
Justly and uprightly.
Justly and uprightly.
And according to law.
And according to law.
And that I will support the Constitution.
And that I will support the Constitution.
Of the State of Georgia.
State of Georgia.
And the Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Well, thank you very much. And let me just simply state to you at this time, we're delighted to have you with us. Chief Justice Carley coined a phrase. He says, what you can do is you sign the roll and you pay a nominal amount, which unless they change the law, still means a small amount, but it's from you will get a certificate suitable to frame. So with that, let me say on behalf of all of us how pleasure we are to have you in court this morning and be a part of it. And with that, I'm going to say we have a tradition here to have a few opening remarks and remarks to the new committee before this bench today. That high honor and privilege falls upon me. So I would like to speak with you just very briefly, but it's really speaking with you on behalf of the court. Probably well over 230 years ago, James Madison, who is considered in many respects the father of the Constitution, wanted General George Washington to come to the Constitutional Convention. He knew for it to be a success, he was the one person that had to be there. Now remember, George Washington, at the age of 43, had led the Continental Army successfully against the greatest military power that existed in the world. And he was a little tired and kind of worn out. He really did not want to go. He thought he had done enough for this legendary country. James Madison got George Washington to come to the Constitutional Convention with 8 words. He said, General, you must. You are the indispensable man. And I will submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, that as attorneys, you are the indispensable people in the noble profession of law and for the rule of law. It is extremely important that you represent people honestly and fairly and zealously, and to do your best for your client, and to be kind and considerate of all peoples. I know there are times I mentioned my son just a few minutes ago, and I asked him one time, I said, how can you, I kept playing football, and he And I kicked the field goal, it was in the fourth quarter, 2 minutes left, and we're up by, we get behind by two. It's about 45 yards from the beginning of the lane. Do you ever get scared? He said, sure you do, Dad. I said, well, what did you do? He said, well, I'm in it. He said, you just got to play through it. And I submit to you, there are times that you just need to play through it, because there are going to be some hard times out there. My dear friend and colleague, David Thomas, also mentions this. He mentions the importance of playing it forward. You know, Frank Sinatra had a song, it was a wonderful song, My Way. It was truly a horrible philosophy. You just don't always do it your way. You got to have help along the way. And there are people that have helped all of us, and Justice Thomas is good about saying this. He says, you can play it forward. Take a little time and call somebody that's helped you kind of get where you live, say thank you. Make you feel good and let me know. And I know they will really appreciate you. Remember that the philosopher, English philosopher John Donne said, no man is an island in time than himself. I say himself or herself now. Thank you for finding that at the beginning when the bell tolls. And the last thing is this. Presiding Justice Harold Melton, as good as thing is, bloom where you planted. Wherever you are, do your best. Do your best for your clients. Do your best for your friends. Do your best for your students. Do your best by profession. If you do that, I promise you success will come your way. Bonnie Clark is a former president of our state bar of doing, and she says this too. And the fact, always being, they kind of look at everything through the eyes of kindness. So I get more and more that is looking through the eyes of kindness. And you kind of look at that joint guide here for the races in your actions. We wish for you individually, we wish for you professionally, success, and prosperity. We wish for each of you individually, health and happiness. We look forward to seeing you walk forward in the future. And with that, I guess you can go sign the roll, pay the nominal fee, get this wonderful certificate that is suitable for you. Thank you very much. This way. And we'll go tomorrow. I'll ask our clerk if she would please my first out of my first game, my first, you know, in some place you can't get the game out of your mind.
Even if marginally relevant, the prejudicial value, the prejudicial effect, that's capacity exceeds any possible role of the appellate.
Counsel, the motion for limiting actually didn't relate at all to the CEO's compensation. It related instead to evidence of Chrysler's participation in the bailout and other matters related to Chrysler's assets.
Your Honor, the motion to eliminate referred specifically to Chrysler's financial condition and in financial status and wealth. Your Honor is correct that the motion did not specifically reference the money paid to the CEO, but we would submit that in this case, the evidence of the money Chrysler paid to its CEO obviously speaks volumes as to Chrysler's wealth and financial condition. If I were to say Mr. Smith pays his valet $1 million, that sure talks a lot about Mr. Smith's valet's wealth, but it also speaks about Mr. Smith's wealth.
That's an indirect inference, and you didn't argue that inference in your motion in limine. You talked about the party's wealth, and the wealth evidence rule that you say is so ingrained is generally more about the party's wealth, not the witness's financial compensation as a matter of bias.
Your Honor is right that historically, when this issue has arisen before this court, it does involve the wealth of a party. In this court's early cases, that is how the general rule is phrased. But in the Reed case, this court specifically held that the general rule applicable to parties also applies to witnesses.
Yeah, I mean, we have one case in which we, with almost no reasoning, without citing rule, the predecessor of Rule 622, and without citing any of the contrary cases, both before and after, applied that rule to witnesses. Is that your only authority applying the rule to witnesses?
It's our only authority that applies the rule to witnesses, but I will submit, as I said in response to the prior question, we do think that this evidence was highly probative of Chrysler's wealth. And I think even if this court were to ignore what it said in Reed, and we certainly treated the language in a published opinion of the majority of this court as binding, even if one were right.
We often have binding cases, but we also have other binding cases, right, that say that wealth evidence, well, it's not wealth evidence, evidence of the financial incentives of a witness is admissible for bias, at least relevant for bias, right? We have dozens of those cases, right?
There are certainly cases where when you show, for example, that a witness has another lawsuit pending against one of the parties and therefore has a direct personal financial interest, yes, that has been deemed admissible. Another example is in the context of expert witnesses. But I am not aware of any case that has suggested that any time you have a corporate employee, that evidence of that employee's compensation, benefits, bonuses, again, untethered from any sort of incentives, just general compensation, is relevant admissible evidence for bias. No court in the country holds that.
Do you agree that there's not positive cases of the law on the subject? What would you say is your best authority?
I think our best authority is the series of cases from this court endorsing the common law rule that begins with the 1922 decision of Smith, then it tracks up through the Crisp case, it tracks up through Rackett, it tracks up through Bailey, and it's also reflected in Reed and Denton and other cases. The Georgia legislature has specifically provided that the common law rules of evidence shall continue to govern absent a specific evidentiary provision that overrules it. And we submit, in this case, that is an unbroken chain of more than a century of this court's precedent saying you can't introduce this stuff into evidence.
But isn't this stuff evidence of the party's wealth rather than of an employee, as Justice Nahmias said?
Well, again, Your Honor, we believe that this court made clear that the general rule is not limited to parties. We also believe that this evidence was probative of Chrysler's wealth. In other words, the plaintiff's argument, at its heart, is that this is a company that can afford to pay its senior executive very large amounts of money. Therefore, you need to issue a large damage award in an amount commensurate with the amount they pay their CEO. That's not an inferential argument on my part. That's the transcript. That's what they argued in closing argument.
So let's say that the evidence was, let's assume for purposes of argument, the evidence was properly admitted for bias. Wouldn't the right thing to do when that argument was made be to request a limiting instruction?
Well, we did object at the time, Your Honor. We simply said at the beginning of closing arguments, we anticipated that this would come up, and we made that argument. Then when the evidence came
What argument?
We made
did you ask specifically for a limiting instruction that it not be used other than to discuss the bias of the CEO?
We did not, Your Honor, because at the time the trial court had not articulated that this was coming in purely for bias or for purposes of bias. That was the rationale that really found its first manifestation in the Court of Appeals opinion.
Well, one of the problems, though, is once it's admitted as evidence. And unless you get a limiting instruction, it's evidence, right?
That's how evidence works. I take your point, Your Honor, but at the same time, it seems to me that the rationale, and again, the trial court didn't speak volumes as to why this was coming in. Prior to the argument, we objected and we said...
On what ground, specifically?
We re-urged the same grounds we had previously urged.
Which were what?
Which were the common law rule prevents this from coming in. We re-urged it and we objected again when he went to that, when counsel went to that information during the close.
On what ground?
The common law rule, and we restated our prior objections.
Did you mention Rule 403 at any point during that?
During that sequence, I don't think we did, but we did mention Rule 403 in the trial court.
At closing, did you mention 403?
I don't believe we did, Your Honor.
Did you ask for a limit, assuming it's admissible for bias, as Justice Green said? Did you ask for any limiting instruction, limiting it to use for bias?
We did not, Your Honor, but again, the trial court had not articulated that this was coming in just for bias. If he had, then I think we would have been much better positioned to say, Your Honor, we want you to hold you to your prior rationale, but we didn't have that benefit. That was something that came in later.
That's a problem. Don't you ask the court for a rationale? You don't get to assume the court is using some improper rationale, or assume I don't know what the rationale is, and not make an objection. If you want to make a proper objection, you have to figure out if you have a doubt about why it's admitted. You have to find out why it would be objected, right?
Well, I take your point, Your Honor. At the same time, I think our trial counsel did absolutely everything within his power to object, to get with the motion to eliminate that we filed, to when this first came in, to mistrial, and then again during closing argument. There's no question the plaintiff's argument about waiver is confined to the so-called Rule 403 objection. So even if Your Honor thinks, well, you didn't preserve 403, which again, we think we did. The Court of Appeals, in its opinion, said Chrysler's arguing prejudice, they pitched the question on the merits. So this court typically will review decisions on the merits by the Court of Appeals if they voluntarily go out or give any purported waiver decided. So we think it's in here. But even if this court were to disagree, we still prevail by virtue of the common law rule. The plaintiffs have never argued that we waive any objection on that ground.
What is the basis for the common law rule? Is it essentially a rule of relevance?
I think, Your Honor, that the common law rule's basis is best described as a specific application of the traditional relevance prejudice balance. Wealth evidence obviously has a long history in civil litigation in this country, and that people will try to get it in one way or the other. So it's unsurprising that this court, fairly early on, recognized the common law rule, quoting Smith, where he said, inadmissible unless it is that extraordinary case where it is specifically relevant. The term this court uses necessarily.
Smith was about party wealth, right?
It was.
Party wealth is irrelevant because it urges the jury maybe to find damages or not damages based on party wealth. Bias of a witness is an entirely different analysis, right?
Well, I was...
They may overlap, as you say, because one may bear on the other, but they're right. Different analysis, right?
Well, I'm not sure about that. In other words, I don't think there's any basis for reading the bias statute in the vacuum and saying anything that ostensibly goes to bias comes in, particularly when it had the effect of overriding the common law rule.
Well, that's where you 403 would come in.
So, well, not necessarily. In other words, it would be our position that the bias provision, the evidentiary approach, is not overruled, just well-settled common law.
Let me ask you a question about that. You just said the common law rule is based on relevance and prejudice, a specific analysis. Assuming you were right, we have a new evidence code. Our new evidence code adopted Rule 403 and Rule 401 and 402. Those are not analogs of prior Georgia code provisions. And they set the rules on balancing prejudice and probative value and on relevance. We tell that in cases that the relevance analysis under the new code is different than under the old code, right?
Well, I take Your Honor's point.
And one purpose of the new code was to avoid court-made kind of per se balancing rules, of which we had a whole variety. Some of those we've already said no longer exist. Why is this not any different?
Well, I think this is not any different, because this is a question, again, that this and other Georgia courts have addressed for nearly a century. And the rule that has... But under the new code, with respect, Your Honor, I am not aware of anything in the new code that would somehow override what has been a firmly enshrined rule in Georgia case law. What the legislature says is that the evidentiary code will override the common law if it is specifically provided and specifically says so. And rules 402 and 403 simply state the general test for relevance and prejudice. And there's nothing in there that suggests when the legislature enacted even the new code that was overruling more than a century of this court's case law. That's our position. If I could add one additional point to Your Honor's question about whether Mr. Marcioni, our chairman, was a party or not, I don't think in this case particularly there would be much of a practical difference between the party and the witness. This is the chairman and CEO of the defendant.
What is Chrysler's wealth? What is Chrysler's wealth? What is their, what, how much do they have in assets and income per year compared to their CEO?
I don't know the answer to that
question. There's a pretty substantial difference, right?
I assume so too.
It's not doesn't get all the way.
I assume so too, but our point is simply that even assuming that the amount of compensation issued in this case is, Your Honor, a positive fraction of the overall Chrysler wealth, the fact is that when these financial numbers were put before this jury, it obviously incites the jury. When you say this chairman made $70 million a year, therefore are you going to value the decedent's life at less than that, that's a completely improper argument. It's not relevant. It doesn't show bias. And the fact that these numbers were put into evidence obviously signaled to the jury that this was a large, quote-unquote, wealthy company.
They weren't put into evidence in closing because what's said in closing is not evidence. So the concern that I have is that what was said in the wide latitude that is offered lawyers in closing argument, the threat that is allowed by trial judges to give them permissible range to argue any inference from the evidence, what was objectionable about what was said by the plaintiff in closing argument? There was, as I read it, there was no methodology put forward that you should give X number of dollars because he makes $68 million a year. In fact, what was said was, we ask that you return a verdict for the full value of Remington's life to at least $120 million. The amount is totally up to you. That's less than 2 years of what Mr. Marcioni made last year. He made $68 million last year.
And
given a wide latitude, given that it's not evidence, was there a motion in limine or a discussion objections made at the time of the charge conference or prior to closing?
Well, let me take a number of questions. With regard to what was wrong with that, the problem with that is that in the state of Georgia, and so through every state in the union, a defendant's wealth is irrelevant.
He's not a defendant. We're past all that.
Well,
he's not a defendant.
Fair enough. The wealth paid to a defendant's CEO is not relevant to the amount of compensatory damages in a wrongful death case. Georgia law says wrongful death damages are measured by the value of the decedent's life. Even granting the reasonably wide discretion lawyers have to make closing arguments, I'm not quarreling with Your Honor on that one, but even granted that discretion, this argument was well over the line.
Was there a question asked without objection of another witness that the child who died could potentially grow up to be a car CEO?
That question was asked.
Without objection.
I do not recall if that question was objected to, but
I don't think it was. So why can't you then, in closing, say this child could have grown up to be a car CEO? Now, linking it to a specific salary may be questionable, but I mean, that point of a basis for what this child could grow up to for his expected life, especially in the face of your client's arguments that we should just assume this child would be a ne'er-do-well and not make anything. Why is that not an acceptable argument?
Well, first of all, that's not the argument that we made, the one Your Honor just articulated. But putting that aside, the argument about why can't you say you could have grown up to anything, under that rationale, you could introduce the salary of Jeff Bezos and say, well, this is not...
No, again, not the salary, but the argument he could grow up to be a car CEO. Now you have the evidence, again, you can ask for limiting instruction, what a car CEO might make.
But, again, Your Honor, it's our position that is an impermissible line of argument among other reasons with regard to he could have grown up to be.
Mr. Dickler, my understanding, your argument is this. The common law has this tradition, and you're saying the common law should not come in. Isn't that
That is the heart of our argument, Your Honor. We also think it should have been excluded under 403. This court need not reach the Rule 403 issue if it rules in our favor on common law. I'd like to reserve the remainder of my time.
And Mr. Lyle, I believe you're going to argue on the 903.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice. To me, question one suggests that y'all might have been concerned with whether the compensation that a party receives is a witness is going to be invariably admissible without regard to Rule 403. Problem with that is Chrysler didn't argue 403 balancing at the Court of Appeals. In fact, in their opening merits brief to you, they criticized the Court of Appeals for not even considering 403. We pointed out that's because y'all didn't cite 403 at the Court of Appeals, and then in the reply brief, Chrysler spins around and says, no, the Court of Appeals considered and rejected our 403 argument. I hope that one of y'all will ask Chrysler, on what page did you cite Rule 403? Because here's the truth. Chrysler argued the opposite of 403 balancing to the Court of Appeals. They argued the trial court had no discretion even to admit this compensation of Chrysler's CEO because it's supposedly governed by the old common law rule on party level. There are two problems with these cases that I think have been thoroughly exposed during the earlier question. First, they follow a common law rule of evidence rather than applying our new 2013 evidence code to this 2015 trial.
And your argument is, what I already understand, is that the new evidence code said one thing.
Absolutely. Our new evidence code tells you how you assess probative value and how you weigh prejudicial value under 402 and 403. The second problem with those old common law cases, even if we didn't have a new evidence code, is that they are all about party level, which the cases say is simply irrelevant, and for good reason. They don't address the compensation a party pays a witness, which is relevant to that witness's credibility and bias.
All but read.
Let me go straight to read, and then I want to get back to talking about the code, if that's all right. So,
an expert witness is commonly asked, how many do you
pay? Absolutely, and the rationale is exactly the same. The rationale for an expert witness is you're going to shade your testimony to favor the party who's paying you. You think about an expert has many clients. A witness, a highly paid executive, depends on one client, if you will, for all of his or her future compensation.
Along those lines, does it matter whether the employee is receiving 100% of their income from the corporation as opposed to what the actual amount of that income might be? In other words, why do you have to state the actual dollar amount to make the point that you're trying to make, which is bias? Obviously, he works for Chrysler. Why do you have to show actual dollar amount?
Sure. Okay. I've got a couple of line of questions right now. Let me maybe start with that and work back to Reed. So the right line of case law to look at, and you guys are very clear in Davis versus State in 2016, are federal decisions, particularly 11th Circuit decisions, applying rules 402 and 403. So the federal courts have not accepted the limitation that you just suggested, Justice Melton. The Court of Appeals cited Bank Atlantic, which is an 11th Circuit case, where the party's chairman, highly paid executive, testified. The amount of his compensation went into evidence, and the Court of Appeals in the 11th Circuit said no abuse of discretion, and one of the rationales is that it goes to bias and credibility. Another case we cite in our brief, these are on pages 14 to 15, is Mendenhall versus American Booksellers. Another case of the party's chairman testifying, so this is a highly compensated executive, court held, his compensation is germane to the loyalty he may feel towards the organization and hence to potential bias. Furthermore, it is the magnitude and not merely the fact that such compensation would bear on credibility. Now, I agree with you, the trial court would have discretion in an individual instance to say, I think the fact is enough, you don't need the amount. But that's not the discretionary call this trial court
made. That discretion would come under 403.
It would, assuming that objection is properly raised to the trial court.
I just want to be very clear, because I think you say this in some of your briefs, that you concede that any reading that if it comes in under 622 trumps any prejudice analysis is incorrect. If that's what the Court of Appeals was trying to say, that's wrong, and 403 can be properly raised.
I don't need you to hold, and I'm not suggesting that 622 always trumps 403. That's right. If I were writing an opinion, what I would say, maybe it's called the language, is that 622 adds another thumb on a scale that is already heavily tilted towards admission. Right, because the Rule 403 calculus is already heavily tilted towards admission. I mean, the ink's barely dry in England versus State, which y'all wrote unanimously last week. And you said Rule 403 is an extraordinary remedy, which should be used only sparingly. The balance struck in favor of admissibility. That's what the trial court is supposed to do. And then when you get on appeal, you are particularly deferential. This is how you describe the appellate standard.
In reviewing issues under Rule 403, we look at the evidence in the light most favorable to its submission, maximizing the value and minimizing its prejudicial impact. Viewed through that lens, I do not believe that you will write an opinion that says it was an abuse of this discretion for this trial court to admit this evidence on witness credibility.
Did you actually argue this evidence as a bias issue?
So we argued the basis for admission to the trial court as bias and admissibility. I know that you probably know that at the bottom of 1771 and 1772. Did we explicitly argue it to the jury as a basis for bias and credibility? No. And that's just a judgment call. You know, my co-counsel is a seasoned trial lawyer who makes judgment calls like that all the time. And within his judgment, if the jury doesn't already get that a highly paid executive with these numbers is disposed to take or testify favorably to Christberg, there's not a lot of point to saying again.
Let me ask you again, though. I asked, why do you have to ask the actual dollar amount? I think your answer was, the 11th Circuit said you didn't have to, but what's the rationale for why you need to show the number in order to show bias and the actual fact that he's making 100% of his high-level compensation going up?
Well, the strength of bias matters, not just its existence, is the rationale.
Well, 100% of income is pretty strong. You know that he's dependent on, regardless of what his livelihood is. You need an actual dollar amount. And is it more inflammatory when you actually bring in a dollar amount?
I don't know. What I know is that calculation should be made by the trial court. And the trial court should decide whether the probative value of the high number of compensation is sufficiently indicative of bias and lack of credibility that the prejudicial value doesn't substantially outweigh. I stated that often, but I think you know what I'm saying. This all goes to the discretionary rule for calculation.
That goes into admission and is evidence for bias of trial. The most troubling thing to me is the closing argument, where it's not argued as bias, but it's at least mentioned in the context of calculation of damages.
Let's talk about that then for a minute. There are two things about the closing argument. First is, you didn't grant Chrysler's separate request to review that on cert. The use in closing, as I think has become clear from the question, is a different trial court ruling and a different issue for what the evidence is.
We often look at how things are used in closing to evaluate prejudice in all kinds of situations.
You might if you were sort of general error reviewing this record, but you granted cert solely on the admissibility question.
Fear that something might be admitted because it might be inflammatory, and it's actually used in an inflammatory way in closing arguments, we will take that into account. So that's the question. Did the plaintiff take advantage of this in an inflammatory way?
Then let's move directly to that. The answer is no. You have to read those comments in context, and here's the context. First, Georgia law gives lawyers and attorneys a great latitude in determining the full value of life damages for a child who's killed before they can ever work or set down an educational path. The second important thing about the context is that Chrysler was arguing for low damages, contending very directly that people from Decatur County just don't make very much money. In fact, the number they proposed worked out to about $57 a day for this young boy's life, the rest of it.
What benchmark did they use?
They said $1.3 million. I can't remember how they got there. If you divide it out, it's $57
right.
A day.
What benchmark in your view should they use?
I don't know that I know an answer for an objective benchmark on that.
Your responsive argument to that clearly could be, well, you shouldn't use that. You should use maybe even how much a CEO of a car company makes. But in your normal case, had the CEO not testified, you wouldn't, there's no question you wouldn't have been able to ask how much the CEO makes, right?
If it weren't relevant to bias and credibility, I doubt we could have gotten this evidence in. I think that's right.
Had Chrysler asked for a limiting instruction, do you think it would have been appropriate for the court to grant one?
When the evidence came in on admissibility? I don't think so, because I think that the context in which we use this is perfectly permissible. And the rest of the context you need to know is that without objection, the question was asked and answered, could Remington Walden have been a fireman, an engineer, a lawyer, or a CEO of a global farmer? That came in, yes, without objection. So when Price is arguing for low vol damages based on small town origins, they obviously want to focus the jury at a lower end of the possible range of outcomes for this young man. We're entitled to at least say, look, he could have been any of these things. He could have been a global car maker CEO. And the number that they're suggesting is a tiny fraction of what their own CEO made in a year. And we're asking for $120 million. By the way,
the only reason that number of what their CEO made came into evidence is to show his credibility.
That is the basis on which the trial court admitted, I believe.
So had the to then eliminate obstruction, you can't argue this for any other purpose.
Had it been sustained, that's right.
Was any sort of limiting instruction ever asked for?
No limiting instruction was asked for when the evidence went on. I mean, they objected to these arguments in closing, I want to be clear about that.
I understand that a linchpin of your argument for bias, at least before this court, was his involvement, the CO's involvement in the meeting with NHTSA. What about in a case where the CO didn't have any alleged direct involvement in creating the problem? Is his or her salary still relevant at that point?
I would be skeptical of that. I would need to know more about the hypothetical. But I think your point is this, and I agree with you. If the facts were different, the CEO were less integrally involved in the most important meetings and the most important issue in the case, then would the trial court or should the trial court have exercised its discretion the same way? I doubt. And I think you would view that case differently.
Now, that is true. On the other hand, does it make the evidence of this high salary even more prejudicial, perhaps, that he's alleged to have taken this great step?
I don't think it makes it more prejudicial. I think it makes it more probative. The jury is entitled to consider the fact that he was dependent on Chrysler for tens of millions of dollars of compensation a year when assessing, is this guy telling the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth about what went on in these meetings? And he's the only witness we can ask. Remember, he's the only Chrysler employee in this meeting. It's not like we could have called some other Chrysler witness and asked some different witness about this. Somewhere back along the line, I was asked a question about Reed versus State. The two important things about Reed versus State, first of all, it's pre-evidence code case. We've already talked about that. Second, there is language in it that Chrysler likes that applies the party involved rule to the witness in that case. But what was going on there factually is not someone in trying to invent the compensation that a party had paid this witness. For some strange reason I can't figure out from the opinion, the defendant wanted to do a direct examination of a defense witness and point out the witness's, quote, financial status and, quote, earning capacity. Nothing about bias or loyalty to a party. So Reed, the rationale of Reed is completely different than what the trial court accepted and the Court of Appeals accepted. To me, the critical thing is, you have pointed us to Davis versus State, federal decisions, particularly 11th Circuit decisions, addressing rulings under the federal rules. We have cited on page 14 to 15 of our brief, on point federal cases, admitting evidence like this for exactly the purpose we say it should have been in this case.
Then why would you do a best authority?
It's hard to choose among my children, but I like the combination of the 11th Circuit decision in 1992, admitting the salary, upholding the admission of the chairman's salary.
You're arguing from authority. Okay.
I like the combination of that with your Davis opinion that says look to a 7-11th Circuit law. To me, that is a 1-2 punch that Chrysler cannot possibly survive. And that's why they're trying to shoehorn this case into a rigid common law rule of evidence.
Which of those cases before those?
So they're recorded on pages 14 and 15 of our brief. I'll particularly direct you to Bank Atlantic from the 11th and Mendenhall, which is a federal district court decision.
Can I ask you just to be absolutely clear, the Court of Appeals, in stating its conclusions at the outset of the opinion, says evidence of a witness's relationship to a party is always admissible. Is it your view that they should have said it's always relevant?
Well, this is what, I mean, this is what they said. They said, fumbling for pages here, but what they said was any concerns about prejudice in this instance must yield to the statutory
mandate. They said that later. They say at the beginning of the opinion, evidence of a witness's relationship to a party is always admissible. Is that correct?
Probably should say always wrong. I think that's right. But if this case is viewed under the 403 lens, Chrysler cannot win. They cannot satisfy you under the stringent standard of Anglin versus State. They cannot satisfy you. There was abuse of discretion in this instance. So I will yield the rest of my time to my colleague, Mr. Bob, to please support.
Someone can address the second issue.
I decided not to, because there's no questions, but I can, Your Honor. I'd like to say one thing, if I might, before I get on the firing line, this reminds me of that old TV show. Because I think this is important. FCA represent, I call it FCA because that's the real name, represented twice on page 3 of the reply brief that, quote, the rule 403 objection was both presented to and decided by the Court of Appeals, close quote. Those representations by this defendant to this court are plainly and indisputably false. And that strikes me as important, because that is the first question this court ordinarily asks. Ordinarily, this court asks the question, was the argument made below and preserved? And to get over that hurdle, this defendant has made representations to you that are plainly and indisputably false. The only time 403 was ever mentioned before this court granted cert on June 30, 2017, was in the chamber brief, applicant's jury brief. And the chamber's lawyers were savvy enough not to say that 403 was raised below, but just to suggest it. I've looked at every page of volume 11 trial transcript. I've looked at every brief filed before June 30, 2017. You will not see the word 403 in any of the court appeals or this court. This defendant didn't even raise 403 in his petition for certiorari or in his reply in support.
You see arguments based on relevance and prejudice.
You see well-evidence arguments, that's it. You don't see the word 403, and you don't see the word prejudice, Mr. Justice Milton, except in the context of this argument about wealth evidence. That's it. There is no suggestion of prejudice versus probative value at all.
Is 403 a magic word standard? Do we have to see the word 403 if they argue relevance and prejudice? Let's say that they did straightforwardly argue that the evidence was more prejudicial than it was relevant. If they don't say the words 403, have they waived it?
Madam Justice Grant, I was raised by a Superior Court judge. I tend to view things through the lens of the Superior Court judge. His name was Richard Neville, coming to me. And I don't think a defendant can argue for a 403 analysis by this court when the defendant gave the trial court not the slightest hint that they wanted the trial court to conduct a 403. And I don't think a defendant can argue to this court that the Court of Appeals erred by failing to conduct a 403 analysis when the defendant never asked the Court of Appeals to conduct a 403 analysis. My understanding, there's a reason that this defendant elected up until June 30, 2017, not to mention 403 or 403 balancing or prejudice versus poetry. And but to put all of its eggs in one basket, wealth evidence. And the reason is, there's no way this defendant could win an argument that the trial court erred under 403, even if the defendant had made a 403 objection to the trial court. Let me point out.
Can you address the second issue? You only have a couple minutes. Can you address
the
second third issue?
I wanted to defend my closing argument, but I'll move because I'm quite proud of that. I will say, Mr. Dupree said that I argued to the jury that you use Marshall's pay as a benchmark. I've read that closing argument. I don't know anything about that. All the arguments are damaged printed right there. I'd like to spend it before. That is a false statement. Read it closely. I responded to FCA's attempt to channel the jury into looking only at the economic component of the full value of life. That's what I did. And I used Marshall's pay to mock their talk about how because of a small town young boy from small town parents in Peter County, his life is on broken. That's purely the economic part. Now to answer Justice question. There are problems with this court's questions. Respectfully, this court has clearly been misled as question one. The Court of Appeals didn't find always admissible. It didn't find it was admitted to show party basis. Well, it didn't say anything about 403. As question two, the Court of Appeals simply did not fail to consider prior awards in similar cases. They didn't do it. There's nothing the Court of Appeals says they did that.
Just to be clear, do you agree that prior awards should be considered? They may not be controlling, but they should be
That, to be honest, I have not been able to make up my mind about the answer to that question. Because there's a lot of case law out there that says they may not do nothing, like Court of Appeals said. There's other case law that says they are only slight, I forget the next word, significance, slight use, that's the national federal county one case, and others. And the problem with FCA's argument is FCA wants you to create legislation, let's be honest, a new standard for what appellate courts and trial courts do to evaluate excessiveness. We all have three standards. One is the jury's line of conscience, the second is the arbitrator's statute, and the third is the death warrant or space cases. Thank you, Governor.
Just a few points on our first, with regard to the questions about preservation, I wanted to identify on page 1974 for the record, our trial counsel objected to the admission of the evidence as quote unquote unduly prejudicial, which goes to Justice Melton's point about making the same relevance, prejudice, excessive prejudice arguments, even though they didn't say Rule 403.
Context for that?
Yes, Your Honor.
That was a couple, quite a bit after.
That's correct, Your Honor. That's correct. But the trial court addressed it. He didn't say too late. He resolved it on the merits.
It doesn't matter what the trial court. You don't get to raise it too late.
It was in the context of the mistrial motion that we made after the evidence had come in. Your Honor, it's correct. The other point I wanted to identify is page 1975 of the trial transcript. And this goes to Your Honor's questions about did we try to somehow prevent this evidence after it had been admitted from being used in the way that it was. And our trial counsel said, we move in limine, Your Honor, should you deny our motion for a mistrial, to prevent the plaintiff's counsel from arguing that Mr. Marcioni's compensation or any other financial circumstance of defendant Chrysler is somehow a yardstick or a measure by which they should calculate damages in this case. We made that exact argument to the trial court after it came in, but before he made his closing argument. Let me make a few points on the remittiture. It is our view that the Court of Appeals erred by simply getting back of the hand and treatment and refusing to consider comparable cases that have previously been affirmed in Georgia for wrongful death and pain and suffering. It's not our position that in every case there necessarily would be comparable cases, but had the Court of Appeals looked at the cases, we identified literally dozens of what we thought were comparable cases, had it engaged and said, look, we've looked at the facts, we think this is unique, maybe that would be okay, but that's not what they did. They simply said, no two cases are alike, therefore we're dismissing it out of hand.
What's the range above sort of comparable case awards that would be permissible under your understanding of the process of laws?
Our understanding is that the largest prior award is not a cap. It certainly, a new award certainly could exceed what has gone before.
So what's the rule for us?
I think the rule for this court to articulate is that a court of appeals or a trial court, when conducting a remittiture analysis, needs to consider whether there are comparable cases, and if so, then examine the award in the instant case, two prior awards. The award in this case, the wrongful death award, exceeded the aggregate of all wrongful death awards ever upheld in the history of the state of Georgia.
Why would you consider awards upheld on appeal as evidence of what juries return as acceptable value? It's a huge universe of cases that don't get to appeal.
Because as the 11th Circuit explained in the Bravo decision, those decisions are relevant, ones that have been upheld, because they have been validated as
sure,
permissible.
More validated, but why would we ignore everything else?
Well, simply because the everything else has not been held to be in conformance with state law. For example, under that approach, if we said, well, we're going to consider anything any jury has ever awarded, regardless of whether it was actually reviewed by a judge, the $150 million award in this case would be a relevant benchmark. That can't be right. Even the plaintiffs acknowledge that the $150 million award in this case was vastly excessive.
And in this case, the parties pointed out what you get to with the award we look at. But in cases where the defendants don't fight it, why would we assume that that's an improper award that the defendants can be seeking?
Well, a lot of times cases do settle, but of course we don't know the amount that they settle for. And there are some examples of cases where there's a large verdict. Both parties realize that will probably get vindicated, so therefore rather than fight through the appellate process, they settle. And in that circumstance, since we don't know, because the 11th Circuit pointed out, it doesn't make sense to consider those awards. So in conclusion, if I could say, when a jury awards $150 million in non-economic damages in a single fatality case, something is amiss. What happened here was wrong, it was impermissible. We ask this court to reverse the remand with instructions to grant Chrysler a new trial.
Thank you. Thank you.
will not be participating in this case. So we will not participate. And with that, Madam Clerk, if you will sound the next case.
S-17A-1804, WXIA-TV et al. Versus the state et al. Derek Bauer for appellant, Michael Gallen for appellate.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court, Justice Barlow, and I'm with the argument before you as well today. My name is Derek Bauer. I'm here with my law partner, Ian Bernstein, and our colleague, Burnside, and our colleague, Craig Wiggington, who are here on behalf of the appellant, WXIA-TV 11Y, and WMAZ Channel 13 in Hague. As the court knows, this case involves the rarest of judicial remedies, a prior restraint in the form of a gag order, and the need for clarity from this court regarding the legal standard governing such orders, and perhaps even more importantly, the due process that is required before such an order may permissibly be entered under the constitutions of the United States and the great state of Georgia. Two television stations, WMAZ 13 in Macon and 11 Live News in Atlanta, appealed in March 27, 2017, gag order entered by the Superior Court of Irwin County in a criminal case in which Ryan Alexander Duke is accused of murdering Kara Princeton in 2005. And we respectfully ask this court to vacate that order. I know the court is well acquainted with the facts that gave rise to the entry of the gag order and the procedural history that led to its modification, but perhaps for the benefit of our guests, I offer the following brief summary. Ms. Grinstead is a native from Hopkinsville, Georgia. She's a popular Lasilla school teacher, a former Miss Tiffin, and a contestant in the Miss Georgia contest when she disappeared one night in 2005 after a family gathering. Her case has been the subject of intense, interesting concern for her South Georgia community since her disappearance. And the 12-year-old case had become the largest file in GUI history when a tipster broke the case this past spring and led to the arrest of Mr. Duke on murder charges and another individual on aiding and abetting charges. The case was beyond cold. It had been back frozen in place until the tip came in. And as the record before this court shows, when Special Agent Rickinson of the GBI announced the arrest of Mr. Duke in a press conference in late February, he first thanked Ms. Grinstead's family and the Osceola community for their steady and patient support of the long-running investigation, and then he thanked the media. And he said the media attention to the case was, quote, phenomenal. And he specifically noted that without the continuing media attention to the case over the past decade, he was confident, his word, confident, the case would not have been broken. It is certainly true that the mystery of Ms. Grinstead's disappearance has generated substantial press attention, undoubtedly more than the average murder case. And I don't think appellants would contest that Mr. Duke's arraignment has a more substantial media presence than the trial court is accustomed to seeing for such proceedings, preliminary criminal proceedings. The trial court's reaction to that presence was a sweeping gag and closure order, silencing anyone and everyone who had information about the case, including Ms. Grinstead's family, and speaking about the case to me, anywhere, sealing all court filings and records related to the case and closing the courtroom for all going forward proceedings. The news media appellants and other media outlets moved to intervene, challenging prior to that order, both by all of those orders, excuse me, and after hearing on my motion, the trial court entered a modified order that is now issued. Today. That order, as the court knows, narrowed the gag order to limit it to the trial participants, that's parties, lawyers, and witnesses, but also all law enforcement associated with this case since its inception for over a decade, and to limit the scope of the subjects that are restricted to those that generally track the advisory limitations in Rule 3.6 of the Lawyer Professional Conduct Rules in Georgia. Notably, all of this happened before even Mr. Reed was. The news media appellants contend the modified order, even as narrow, remains unconstitutional and due to debate.
Are there any factual findings that would have allowed that kind of gag order?
Not in this case.
Right, but in the world of hypothetical scenarios, are there factual situations that would allow this type of gag order? Factual findings by court that would allow this?
They're very well put, and the Supreme Court has always left open, the U.S. Supreme Court has always left open the possibility that such factual scenario could arise. In Shepard v. Maxwell, which was a notorious case in the 60s, there was all sorts of intrusion and inundation of trial proceedings by the media. They were literally seated with the jurors in the jury pool, and the
roundabout way of answering your question, but it's difficult to imagine, and the U.S. Supreme Court has said it's difficult to imagine a factual scenario that would ever justify. Again, it's truly the rarest of cases. It is the remedy of last resort.
Well, I just want to be clear. The use of prior restraint, and prior restraint is a restraint on somebody from speaking. This may be characterized as a prior restraint on the trial participants and the other people who were restrained by the order. There is absolutely no restraint imposed on the media, right?
Well, there's certainly an indirect restraint.
Not an indirect restraint, but the prior restraint language, other than in some, particularly a couple pretty old and not particularly carefully reasoned cases that you cite, I mean, prior restraint, the way the U.S. Supreme Court has used it is ordering somebody not to publish or not to speak. Nothing at all directly orders your clients not to publish or speak anything, right?
That is absolutely correct.
That just may alter the standard of review, but
it shouldn't. And let me explain why.
There's not a lot you answer that, but if you tell them with particularity, the way you say it is a prior restraint, we're in the order of the prior restraint, and where you think reasonable accommodations could have been made without the restraint.
Well, Your Honor, it is clearly a prior restraint. It directly prohibits speech by lawyers who are representing parties, lawyers who are representing non-parties in the form of Mr. Dukes, who's the other individual who was arrested, who's not a party to this case.
Do you have standing to raise any of their First Amendment rights?
We do, Your Honor. The media is the proxy for the public's right to know.
The public's right to know.
That's correct.
But to raise a First Amendment violation of those people's rights, what's your best guess?
Well, it's long settled, Justice Nahmias, the First Amendment protection of the press includes within its ambit the right to receive information from public speakers. Every court to address this question has acknowledged that an impairment of the press's right to receive from speakers is an injury under the First Amendment that authorizes the media to intervene and seek redress. Most recently, the Fourth Circuit addressed this just.
And I'm not arguing with that principle, but the principle that it's reviewed as a prior restraint as opposed to a limitation on free speech.
Well, the United States Supreme Court has never distinguished between a prior restraint on non-media personnel versus the media and said, just because we're ordering this category of people not to speak, we don't call this a prior restraint.
So what's your best case for the U.S. Supreme Court using the term prior restraint for a order that was not directed to the party that was before the court?
The United States Supreme Court has never addressed that. And neither has this court. And that is really illustrative of just how rare this judicial remedy is and how disfavored it is. What the U.S. Supreme Court has said is that any prior restraint is presumptively unconstitutional. And what the U.S. Supreme Court has repeatedly told us is that the protection against prior restraints, against anyone, whether it's the media, or lawyers, or law enforcement, or witnesses, anyone, the protection against a prior restraint is the primary guarantee of the First Amendment. The primary guarantee. And the Supreme Court has never said we're going to distill or otherwise weaken that protection for an order that restrains speech of someone who's not media.
That Rule 3.6 is, under your analysis, a prior restraint. It restricts lawyers' ability to say things about every case, every lawyer in Georgia.
It does not, Your Honor. Rule 3.6 is, first of all, it's a rule. It's not a court order prohibiting speech. It's an advisory rule. It gives lawyers the discretion.
Rules can be attacked as unconstitutional, just like statutes or orders.
And the Nevada corollary to Georgia's Rule 3.6 was attacked in Gentile, which the United States Supreme Court held, number one, that kind of rule is only permissible to punish the speech of a lawyer who specifically speaks about topics that are intended or he knew should have resulted in the prejudice of a trial. Only constitutional because those rules contain safeguards, caveats. They are not absolute prohibitions, not even specific categories in which the Supreme Court has said we recognize these things are, of course, inherently prejudicial by nature, but even those categories are not categorically prohibited for lawyers to speak on, because our constitutional jurisprudence, our way of life under the Constitution, doesn't allow the government to say, you can never speak on these topics, period, black and white, with firm, rigid
parameters.
Such a rule, the U.S. Supreme Court said, would be unconstitutional, even in genteel.
Did they use the term prior restraint?
It wasn't prior restraint, because that was the rule that punishes speech after it has happened. A prior restraint says, on punishment of contempt, criminal sanction, if you speak, you go to jail. There's a very big difference between a rule, like the rule.
Punishment, if you speak, you lose your law license. You don't think it, if we got a rule 3.6 that lawyers may never speak to the public about anything, that could not be characterized as a prior, that you would say would not be a prior restraint under your reason?
That would be a prior restraint. I believe the U.S. Supreme Court would say that's prior restraint. It would strike it down as unconstitutional because it doesn't contain important safeguards that allow, number one, for lawyers who are trained to understand and validate these rules, have the discretion to make the determination, is this speech going to prejudice this trial or not? And what the U.S. Supreme Court said in Gentile is if you don't have that cabinet, if you don't have that safeguard, it's an unconstitutional rule. And the U.S. Supreme Court said in Gentile that even as applied, even though the rule itself survives constitutional scrutiny, because we recognize that there need to be some mechanisms to limit what lawyers should speak about when it's a case that they're involved in, that rule is unconstitutionally applied in that case. But law enforcement and lawyers are very different. And that's where this prior restraint goes way, way, way too far.
Okay. Is that the focus you're saying? Restraint, the prior restraint is on the media and law enforcement. Is that the focus of your argument?
Justice Hines, this was a backdoor way to gag the media. But it's a direct gag on the lawyers, the parties, other lawyers and non-parties in the form of Mr. Dukes and his counsel, all potential witnesses, we don't even know who that is. We could be years away from a trial in this case if there ever is one. And most importantly, for purposes, I think, of today's analysis, all law enforcement associated with the case, whether they're retired, whether their relationship to the case was tangential and minimal, whether they're going to be trial participants and witnesses in the case or not. That's a direct prior restraint. But I think what makes clear from the record what the trial court was trying to do, and respectfully, I mean, she has a duty to protect the defendant's right to a fair trial. These are complicated interests to balance and weigh. And so we appreciate her sensitivity to controlling the courtroom and what kind of media attention the case gets. But you can't jump to the prior restraint. You can't assume just because there's intense media attention that the evidence has risen to the level where the court can fairly say, this will impair the trial.
So what should we do? Obviously, let's say that we agree with you that this rule is too broad and is problematic from a First Amendment perspective. What do we tell the court the rule is when we send it back?
I think this court should embrace the standard that it has previously applied in access cases. This court has repeatedly held RFK Page versus Lincoln, Rockdale Citizen versus State, that the First Amendment right of access to criminal proceedings requires clear and convincing proof that no means available other than closure of the hearing serve to protect the right of the movement. And that requires concrete, tangible evidence that can be made part of and attached to the record to enable appellate review of trial court decision on an issue of constitutional magnitude. That has been the standard for closing a courtroom, criminal proceedings to the public, to the press, to anyone in this state for decades.
So I hear your answer is that we would instruct the trial court to consider other means such as what?
There are lots of arrows in the quiver that we have. Strong voir dire, strong jury instructions to the jury, change of venue, delay of a trial. The Supreme Court has told us over and over again that particularly when publicity is distant, temporally distant from the trial date, like it is here, that the passage of time erodes any risk of prejudicial publicity infecting a trial. All of this publicity that happened in this case happened before the defendant was even indicted. But more importantly, we know that these alternatives work. And we don't have to look beyond recent events in the state of Georgia to see how these work. Last summer, we had one of the most high-profile criminal trials in the country in this state, in the Justin Ross Harris hot car death case. We all know about this case. It had far more pervasive, pernicious, inflammatory press coverage in this case could possibly say he said to have had. And in that case, openly the press, disputed evidence was being debated on a daily basis. Nothing like that is in the record here.
You had a change of venue in that case.
Had a change of venue. When the trial court determined that after an extensive voir dire, an impartial jury couldn't be sat in Cobb County, the trial moved to South Georgia. In a week, they had a jury, perhaps successful.
Cobb County is substantially larger than Osceola. Would you concede that there is a level of expectation that if it is so persuasive, pervasive, that the media attention could influence the defendant's right to a fair trial in a town the size of Osceola with roughly, 10,000 people?
Certainly could.
And you say the remedy for that is individual sequestered for Dyer, limiting instructions, and so forth.
All of those are available remedies that the U.S. Supreme Court and frankly this court in the lesser context access cases have said you must not only consider them, you've got to explore them so thoroughly and document the reasons why, with evidence, those remedies, those alternatives would not work. Justice Peterson wrote a beautiful opinion in the Court of Appeals just last year before he submitted to this court, in which he reiterated that standard. And let me submit to this court that if the U.S. Supreme Court has told us constantly that the right of free expression, the right of speech, and the protection against prior restraint is the chief protection, the chief guarantee of the First Amendment, but we require a higher standard than this trial court employed and our Court of Appeals has dictated for access to criminal proceedings, which cannot be more sacred than our First Amendment speech rights. That cannot be constitutional.
Isn't the real question whether what is being released to the press by people the court has power over things it will not influence the fair trial? I mean, if they're talking about what's in the record, if they're talking about what has come out in hearings, that's not a problem. But if there was, and I don't know there is here, if there were evidence of lawyers going out and broadcasting a defendant's confession, that there's a pending motion to suppress a confession, or if you have law enforcement doing the same thing, is that something the court can control other than saying, well, we'll let it taint everybody and then try to sort it out and whatnot?
I'd like to reserve a few minutes for rebuttal, but I really want to answer the question to Justice Nahmias. And of course, if the quantum of evidence about the pretrial publicity rises to the level of demonstrating by clear and convincing evidence that those kinds of communications are being made, that they are pervasive and infecting the potential jury pool, and that's shown in the evidence, then the court can consider, obviously, what remedies it needs to impose to protect that. But it's very important to understand that the U.S. Supreme Court has required no absolute prohibitions on even those kinds of comments, even though we understand inherently those can be very damaging for right of fair trial, because we don't know what context those kinds of communications might be important.
You don't think a court could order a prosecutor, you may not, under any circumstances, tell the press about evidence that I have ruled inadmissible at trial?
I'm not certain the trial court can do that constitutionally, unless there's clear and convincing evidence. And you can't say absolutely, because there has to be a contextual category. We never know if there's some miscarriage of justice, if there's been some kind of information leaked by the prosecutor or the defense that's contrary to that information and it's needed to rebut. Rule 3.6 of the Georgia rules actually specifically speaks to that, Justice Nahmias, and says, you know, these rules generally prohibit you from speaking on these topics, but you are free to speak on these topics if you have to rebut effectively misinformation or damaging information on those same topics that your opponent or the court has issued. I'd like to reserve some time for that. Thank you.
Honorable Chief Justice, members of the court. I'm Michael Gowan. I represent the defendant in this case. Ryan Duke with me is my boss, the Circuit Public Defender John Mobley. Also at the table with us, and unlike the pairing of the District Attorney from our circuit, Mr. Paul Ballard.
Let me ask you, Mr. Minister, Mr. Gowan, what considerations were given prior to the imminent appeal by the court as to what
I think when we initially had the case, as the facts state, we were caught a little bit off guard in that the press conference was held, and immediately subsequent to the press conference, our client was brought into the courtroom. We had a last minute phone call before we even got an attorney over there representing during the preliminary, and the judge went ahead and did a general order, which, of course, has now been invalidated or superseded by this narrow, this more narrowly tailored order.
That wasn't done prior to any hearing thereof.
It was, that's correct, Your Honor. It was not, which, under my reading of the law, is not appropriate under the standards. Of course, we disagree with the strict scrutiny standard that has been proffered by the appellant. What we would submit is the proper standard would be the one that is upheld by the Georgia Court of Appeals in the case of the Atlanta Journal Constitution versus the state in 2004, where that the Court of Appeals adopted the substantial likelihood of material prejudice test. And in that opinion, the court directly stated that, of course, they have the authority, you know, citing back to Gentile, that they have the courts have the authority to enter, well, restraining orders, gag orders, in regard to trial participants. And that's what we have here. We consider the law enforcement, and I think the United States Supreme Court considers law enforcement officers as participants in the trial.
Does that apply to people who are no longer serving law enforcement?
I think it does in this case. Of course, if we have a very, this is an odd case. Granted, this case has been ongoing for 11 years. You know, of course, during that time, we've got folks that have retired.
All right, what control for Brady, for example, you're on the hook if you're a district attorney for what's held by the law enforcement agents. What control do you have over retired people?
Well, we've got the court's order here that they can be held in contempt.
Now, I understand the court ordered it, but what, in general, how are retired law enforcement people still under the trial for this?
Well, we still have, you know, we have all the records, which is about 11 gigabytes worth of discovery that Mr. Bowles obtained from the GBI, which is quite voluminous and contains, is very specific to help us locate and know who the officers are and where they're at. And
so maybe potential witnesses, but it's not limited to potential witnesses, it's retired law enforcement. Is it valid to people who had nothing to do with the case?
I don't think it's valid to people who had nothing to do with the case, Your Honor. I think I would argue that it would, that it applies only to those law enforcement officers who have specific knowledge, who participate in the investigation. For example, the lead investigator of the DBI is now retired. I think that's what the Supreme Court, starting back in the Shepherd case, they recognized that in that case, of course, the pretrial publicity was found to be, I think their word was a carnival atmosphere, and they recognized that one of the ways the court could have limited that atmosphere and done something about it was to instruct the participants in the trial, and they cited law enforcement officers in that opinion as people they had authority over.
And
I would say that would extend to any potential, the work of trial participants.
Counsel, could you address the factual basis for this order, and in particular, what evidence was there presented to the trial court that any persons who are covered by this gag order were in fact disseminating prejudicial information to the public through media or otherwise that was not otherwise in the public record?
If you look at the findings of fact that are in here, the court examined, we tendered 79 different exhibits that were examples of media coverage that took place in about a 23-day period from the time the order was entered till the time that the court issued this order.
Why should we conclude that those are examples of prejudice rather than examples of news stories surrounding the upcoming trial and investigation?
Well, maybe this answers both those questions. For instance, if you look at 10B for the past 4 days. Those are the DBA agents I've been digging for Grin says remains in the Pecan Farm in Benhill County where the suspects allegedly dumped the bodies. It's a possible site where she may have been disposed of. We're finding some things and we're collecting some evidence. We're hoping that we can find the remains, and that's why we're there. Those were items that were not initially disclosed. You can infer some of that from reading the arrest warrants, but those are specific items that only law enforcement have knowledge of.
Why is that prejudicial?
We're concerned that the more detail, we're not asking for, nor do we believe that this order prohibits the media from reporting on the case. But what we're talking about, what we're concerned about is when you get into specific items, such as a confession.
Right, where is that? There is no confession talked about other than the absence of statements.
That's correct, and if evidence were to come up with that, or the gag order is lifted, we have none, then that becomes an issue.
That's the problem, is you normally need at least some evidence of bad stuff happening before you restrain people. As opposed to restraining them because there's some hypothetical possibility bad things will happen. A lot of the exhibits you cite are actually law enforcement agents refusing to comment.
That's correct.
Well, what did you say can be done now under the order that would not be condemned?
Well, the order lists things that can be discussed. We can discuss the identity, age, residence, occupation, family status of the accused, the request for assistance in obtaining evidence, information contained in the public record that is subject to an open records demand pursuant to the law.
Now, I think going back, what is not on the record that had been discussed that would generate possibly the unusual?
That's where we have a problem in that when we start getting into that, and that becomes, to me, part of the record, the things that law enforcement has discovered that if they come out in the reporting of the case, then they become, they could be potentially prejudicial for potential jurors. Right, that's what we're concerned about.
As soon as you actually have some evidence of that happening, maybe you can go to court and get the court to stop it. But what authority do you have for stopping it before there's any evidence that's going to happen?
Well, there's several opinions, some that we cited in the court that recognize the fact that the court is not all-knowing, that there are some things that we just don't know, so
what's your best case for a prophylactic, purely prophylactic act? There are plenty of gag orders out there after people have done inappropriate things. What's your case for doing before there's good evidence?
You want a case or a factual scenario? The one that comes to mind that they cited is the OJ Simpson case, where essentially I think what happened in that case was it was tried immediately, as opposed to being able to, as the courts have said, try within the confines of the courtroom.
I think there was, before the gag order was entered, I think there was plenty of inappropriate public statements by probably every single trial participant in the case. Right?
Yes, sir.
Do you have evidence of that order was entered kind of right after the arrest?
No, in that case, the gag order was not entered whatsoever. Also, as Justice Boggs pointed out, we have an issue with the fact that our jurisdiction contains less than 10,000 people. So we have an extremely small population to draw from in regard to the jury panel.
Mr. Gowan, that might get you to the reaction that justifies by clear and convincing evidence the need for a gag order, but there's not a different rule that applies to Georgia based on jurisdiction, correct?
Correct.
And to the point that whether you haven't cited any authority for a prophylactic sort of measure to prevent, so I'm curious of all of the enumerations that are contained in the judge's findings of fact, which ones do you find to be the most problematic that would require a reactionary gag order and that are supported by clear and convincing evidence? And I think you started, did you not, with the concern about your client being led into the courtroom in shackles and in prison guard, correct?
correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Seems like that was problematic from your perspective.
Yes.
Well, is there any rule that prohibits that?
There is not. At that stage of the proceedings, of course, at trial, that is definitely prohibited. But again, the horse is out of the barn in regard to that. It's on the internet. Everybody gets to see that at this point.
But the remedy for that, if it's happening, is that would clearly require not a gag order, but a courtroom closure, right? And you would have to meet a test. I don't see how you would meet the test. But you didn't try to do it in any event. So once the media has that information, and you try to stop them from showing that, that's clearly a violation, right?
Yes, Your Honor, and we are not asking for the courtroom to be closed at this point for any proceedings.
Isn't a careful voir dire also a remedy?
It is in this case. Again, we're concerned about it. Even if we do, for instance, the changing venue is one of the options that we have. Even a changing venue is going to be a similar jurisdiction in size. And in any event, I mean, there's going to be a careful decision voir dire going to have to be on a case of this magnitude in regard to the pre-trial coverage.
Thank you, Counsel, for confronting all of this. Is a presumption that you cannot get a fair and impartial jury. And what is it right now to say that you can't get a, in your opinion, a fair and impartial opinion upon a fair and impartial jury? And what indication do you have?
We're concerned, you know, as stated with the different things that are in the articles, we're having problems with the social media and the internet is being what it is today. We can look at those things and see, and we're seeing, and I'm, you know, as Ms. Sidon and I know, just because somebody posts anything doesn't even mean they're true. They could be on the other side of the world. But when you see the venom, the hatred, the concern that goes for our client, does make us very concerned.
But that has to all flow from a inappropriate as opposed to entirely appropriate statements made by people covered by the order. Well, the order isn't, of course, the order isn't going to help if people get on and say this lady was killed and it's a horrible thing and whoever got accused of it's a horrible person. You can't stop that, right?
That's correct.
And if they say that based on the indictment or based on media coverage of what happened in court, that's not inappropriate either, is it? In terms of gag order, maybe you need to sift it out and go higher or change it anyway.
Well, one of the things that you may have noticed from the facts, in this particular case, their internet website that's been devoted to this case up in Vantage. And they saw on there, there's approximately 15 million listeners on there. And if you look at Mr. Lindsay's coverage of the trial, I'm sorry, coverage of the case, you see that even without going into the details and the things that we've asked not to be discussed, he's still able to provide media coverage and talk about the case.
Is that prejudicial? Potentially? And so cases, how would you stop it?
Well,
this order's not stopped. This is March 27th, correct?
What we've done...
To their point, you have... The order potentially has the effect of limiting their sources. It hasn't stopped. It hasn't stopped the social media code.
That's correct, Your Honor.
You still think that's prejudicial? Or could be?
I do. When you think about prior restraint, the courts have never ruled. The strict scrutiny standard applies to restraint the media. You know, the media can't come in the courtroom. The media can't ask this question. They can't cover it. All we've asked is that the gag order cover the potential trial participants.
But you can't trace what the trial participants are doing in an inappropriate way to the stuff you're complaining about. This podcast, is there any evidence the podcast is based on anything that this order would prohibit?
Not that we can tell, we monitor this.
Okay, so if that's the case, how can you cite that as basis for the gag?
Well, around it. They're able to cover it without getting into those potential facts that are, we consider will be prejudicial to the case and potential jurors.
Yes, we call that media coverage, right? Are you saying that the court can ban media coverage based on what they learn through the public?
No. I don't think this gag order prohibits them from being able to cover the case. I think what it does, it limits maybe what they want to get into, you know, the sordid details, the kind of things that typically, you know, we would get into in a trial of the case, but I don't think it limits their ability to make a fair coverage of the case and inform the public of the progress and what's going on.
And what evidence are they getting into sordid details that cover from anybody covered by this court?
Well, they're going to come from law enforcement. That's why.
What evidence is there in the record that anything that you call a sordid detail is coming from something that would be prohibited by this court?
That's, you know, again, why we're requesting as a prophylactic purposes.
And that's the presumptive part. If you're presuming something that hasn't occurred.
That's great, Your Honor.
Counsel, to hold anybody in contempt of an order like this, even if the order were valid, it has to be willful contempt, and so it has to be fairly clear to them that they were violating the terms of the order. In provision 1F of the injunction itself, it prohibits these folks from disseminating information that the lawyers know or reasonably should know is likely to be inadmissible and would be prejudicial. How in the world would a retired law enforcement officer know what the lawyers know or what the lawyers should know? That doesn't even make sense to me.
We would have to rely on the fact that during the investigation process that we've spoken with all the officers and, you know,
and told them what's admissible and inadmissible?
Well, Your Honor, if they are retired, they're still certified peace officers and they have received some training instructions. And these officers have appeared in court, they do have some idea, you know, of courtroom proceedings.
That's not what the order says, so it doesn't say what they believe is inadmissible, it's what the lawyer believes is inadmissible.
And I think, you know, the court has the right to give further instructions to the trial court in regard to the order. What we're concerned about here is a balancing test between the media's First Amendment right to cover it and our client's Sixth Amendment right to a fair trial that's not, you know, been prejudiced by details that come out that would be within the province of law enforcement that wouldn't be commonly known. But, you know, again, if you know the way the order is written, it covers their discussing things and talking to the media.
In order to be prophylactic, could a particular judicial circuit have issued this gag rule in all cases before it?
I don't think so.
And so what makes this case different?
I hate to keep going back to it, but this is, you know, in my experience in law enforcement and in criminal laws, the fact that this is 11 years of coverage, it's the largest case file in UGA history, meaning that there's been hundreds of thousands of hours spent on the case. And it's in a small, very small jurisdiction.
Thank you, Mr. Dow. Mr. Biles, for a very brief rebuttal. Justice Hines, you asked what consideration the trial court gave to alternatives to the gag order. There's nothing in the record on which this court can define what consideration the trial court gave. She didn't put anything in the record. She just told us she considered it an objective. This court should not...
The court says in its conclusions that it considered the use of various alternatives and lists them and says they don't consider the appropriate.
It doesn't explain how she considered them, why she decided they were inappropriate or not available remedies that would cure what she intended to be a problem. And, you know, let's just be clear.
this wanton of proof is the mere existence of media coverage, while the defender cannot tell this court, when he's asked at the Supreme Court level, tell me what the most prejudicial item that the trial court had in front of the record, it's that you Justice Boggs were actually providing, which is there's an image of the defendant in his prison guard shot. We are inundated with that every day. Mugshots are open records in this state. Texan fibers on TV every day in his prison guard. If that were the standard for a gatherer, then it would be the most malleable standard, and the First Amendment protections against private attorneys in the state would be utterly porous. Thank you.
I'm honored, Justice Carley, by your being here today.
And I want everyone in this room to know that in the 3 years I've been dean, you have been at every law school graduation, wearing a coat and tie. Makes me a little bit nervous. As much in the same way that you inspire us, I want you to remember the court to know that whenever the court calls, we are here to answer the call. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you, Professor. And Dean Robinson, thank you so much for that. And as Dean Robinson said, let me just say one last word of caution to the students. I know it's a more casual world now than the world I came up in. And certainly that's good. But when you are in the presence of Chief Justice George Carley, you might want to consider if you're a male student wearing a coat and tie. Justice Carley, I'm going to tell you now, Justice Carley would have touched his grass when he did, he wore a coat and tie. We'll be in recess, Dean Robinson, ladies and gentlemen. And so we hopefully have another opportunity to run this wonderful school and have another session. Thank you.
All rise.
Yes, thank you.
official review.
Okay, everybody look right here. One, two, three. Couple more. Okay.
Thank you all so very much.
Either one that you select.
Fantastic.
Okay.
But they
weren't.
My thought is I can swing by brush. They got to look at me. They got to look at me. I know how that is.
Turned into a Wisconsin Badger.
Don't let him do that.
One, two, three. Justice Milton, we have you. Yeah. One, two, three. Here we go. We get a couple. Right here. One, two, three.
No, I didn't
Nobody
catch that
does.
Detail.
Including us.
But it's that time.